welcome all of you to the New Year seminar of our Alliance of Liberals and Democrats in the European Parliament. And this year we thought, yeah, why not taking the topic of Eurobonds? As we are discussing that all the time in our group, we thought that it could be a good topic for our yearly seminar, and maybe to tackle the question if they can bring stability and growth to the euro. And you won't be surprised that if I tell you, certainly not the members of our group, that for me, in any case, the answer is yes, they can. And so, but that's more a slogan for next American elections than for Eurobonds, I think. So I'm a strong believer that it is possible to create a system for the common issuance of bonds, which at the same time can lower the refinancing cost of member states so that we free resources for investment into growth, that at the same time reinforces compliance, and that's very important, with the Growth and Stability Pact, and therefore also strengthens the fiscal discipline in the euro, and that at the same time prepares the ground for establishing the euro as a global reserve currency in the near future. And I can tell you that the recent resolution on the feasibility of introducing stability bonds, where Sylvie was rapporteur and who was voted with a vast majority in our Economic and Monetary Affairs Committee, and the fact that Parliament's representative for negotiating the new treaty have made the introduction of Eurobonds part of their negotiating position show, in my opinion, that support among the major political forces in Europe is growing. There is, I think, a growing consensus that it is possible to create a Eurobond which effectively eliminates moral hazards through fiscal discipline, while at the same time creating the benefits of a sovereign bond market that can be compatible, I should say, with the size of the bond market of the United States. And I also believe that the prospect of establishing a common bond market in the medium term could send a very strong signal to markets, that Europe puts an end to the impossibility of sharing a common currency, but preserving 17 different national economic policies, 17 different national fiscal policies, and also 17 different national bond markets. But we will also have to offer, I think, an immediate solution to the crisis. Because I'm still concerned that member states have not put any bold and promising proposals on the table yet. And that did not change, I think, with the summit of yesterday in Berlin. And this brings me immediately to our first speakers, Professor Christoph Schmidt and Mr. Benjamin Weigert from the German Council of Economic Experts. So welcome, first of all. You will present to us your proposal for what we call a European Collective Redemption Fund. I can tell you, since your report, it has entered in the vocabulary of the European Parliament. And you will, this idea has already gained enormous support within the European Parliament, and not least within my own group. We wish that it could also gain more support in a number of political circles in Berlin. I would also like to welcome Mr. Jacques Delpla, who is a member of the French Council of Economic Advisors, who is co-author of the multiply-sided famous blue bond, red bond proposal. We are more the part of in favor of the blue bond proposal, you know, Mr. Delpla. And I want also welcome warmly Mr. Jean-François Robin, and he is the global head of strategy at Natixis Bank, who kindly stepped in at a very last minute for Mrs. Lawrence Bone, who was unable to travel, but who has put her position on this today in the FT, I have seen. Also, Professor De Grauwe is not participating this morning as he fell ill. He's now not longer a professor in Belgium, but in the London School of Economics. Can be a relation between the two of them, I don't know. So therefore, I'm happy also to welcome Mr. Stuart Holland, who agreed to step in and will join us on the panel later on. But I can tell you that you can find copies of the presentation of Mr. De Grauwe, of Professor De Grauwe, and of Mrs. Bone in the meeting room. So these presentations are available. And last but not least, naturally, I want to welcome the Vice President of the Commission, Olli Rehn, who has taken the courage to stimulate and further advance the debate on Eurobonds by issuing a green paper on the issue. And I think he will already be able to present us, I hope so, the Commission's preliminary findings on the consultation procedure, and maybe also give us some indications on what the next steps will be in this process. But before giving the floor to Olli, I would like my colleague, Mrs. Sylvie Goulard, who is, as you know, the coordinator of our group in the Economic and Monetary Affairs, and who is also the rapporteur of the Parliament on Eurobonds, to make a couple of remarks.
Thank you, Guy. Thank you all for being here. I will be very brief because you're here to listen to the other people. I just wanted to thank warmly Olli Rehn for being here, because if we are here today, it's because we had a very good cooperation with the Commission during the negotiation of the six-pack. And I really want to stress, because I have the feeling that not everybody knows what is in the six-pack exactly, that it was part of the deal we had that the Commission further study this very important topic. The reason why I put the question of the Eurobond in my report last year was that the debate was beginning everywhere but in this Parliament. And I strongly believe that this Parliament is the place where such an issue, for the people who agree, for the people who disagree, has to be tackled. And thanks a lot for the thorough work on the Green Book. Thanks to the staff of the Commission who has done a good work. We are here now in the middle of the road for the Parliament, because you've said that I am the rapporteur. It is an initiative report that we intend to produce. And this resolution we voted in ECON was a first step. It was meant as an answer to the Green Book, but a very preliminary one, and we need your help. It was done also with the support of Sharon Bowles, who is here and who is the chair of the committee. One of the points we wanted really to stress is that it can be a tool to strengthen discipline. And what I wanted through this discussion is to make clear that we have to avoid to look at the Eurobond as something that is bad in principle or something that is good in principle. It's not true. It's a complicated issue. We need to look at all the aspects, the technical ones and the political ones, and show that it is not as simple as some people pretend, and it is not something we should exclude forever. So we are here in the middle, and I leave the floor to everybody. What I'm very happy of is that in the resolution we also tackled a little bit the external dimension of our currency, because I'm puzzled when I see that stability is only looked at in from an inward-looking perspective. Stability is also important worldwide. It is important that the euro can contribute to the stability of the currency worldwide. But I stop here. Thank you very much for all the participants.
Give immediately the floor to Olli Rehn, the Vice President of the Commission and responsible for economic and monetary affairs and for the euro. Olli, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you, Guy, ladies and gentlemen, fellow liberals and other dear friends. Let me first thank Guy and Sylvie and the ALDE group for organizing this very important seminar. It is indeed a very substantive kickoff for the new year 2012. This new year marked the 10th anniversary of the euro. You may have seen no fireworks for this event. Nevertheless, despite some doomsday scenarios that we have read in the press, the euro remains intact. And despite certain systemic shortcomings, it remains our prime political project and the foundation of economic stability in Europe. But this year will also mark a profound transformation of EU economic governance, precisely in order to rectify those systemic shortcomings I refer to. And this is absolutely essential if we want to restore confidence in the European economy. And in this regard, this year needs to mark a turning point. It will be the year when the future governance of the euro will be determined, and it will be the year when a strong monetary union will finally be complemented by an ever closer economic union. And in this context, the seminar and its topic of today is extremely relevant: stability and growth, and what is the role of Eurobonds in achieving that. First, let me set the scene, and then I will say a few words about the Commission's assessment of Eurobonds. The starting point is that the crisis has ravaged the European economy and affected the jobs and welfare of millions of Europeans, and this crisis is by no means behind us. And therefore, the time has come for a new and deeper understanding of the interdependence and accountability that exists within an economic and monetary union. And thus, the time has come for a new and deeper approach to economic integration. This implies striking the right balance between responsibility and solidarity in our economic policy making. In fact, we are facing a dual challenge. On the one hand, euro area member states need to speed up structural reforms to live up to the requirements of sharing a common currency. On the other hand, at European level, we need the right instruments that reflect the reality and requirements of the single currency, especially the right stability instruments. Against this scenario, and before dwelling deeper into the pros and cons of Eurobonds, let me make a few remarks on fiscal consolidation and economic growth. The crisis that struck in 2008 was first tackled by massive fiscal stimulus. Together with major monetary easing, it managed to prevent a replay of the 1930s. However, the stimulus also increased fiscal deficits, and as the state of public finances was vulnerable in several member states, and as the collapse of activity drastically reduced tax revenues, it was quite evident that fiscal policy had to switch from stimulus to consolidation rather sooner than later. For this reason, over the past 2 years, we have promoted gradual and differentiated consolidation. Almost all developed countries face a sovereign debt crisis. Confidence in the ability of governments to service debt has been shattered, and as a result, they have seen high interest rates and weakened trust in the financial banking sector. It is true that further fiscal stimulus would add to demand as such in the short run. But let's not forget, it would also weaken confidence in the current context even further. At the very most, it would provide only temporary relief, and in some countries it would provide not even that, as it would weaken the basis for sustained growth and job creation. And that's why there is no alternative to growth-friendly consolidation. While this is unavoidable, active public policies to promote sustainable growth are at least equally important. And in this regard, I draw your attention to the joint statement of European liberal and democrat leaders in London yesterday. Guy Verhofstadt was there and several prime ministers, deputy prime ministers, and we clearly stated that complementing the single market in the services and digital sectors alone could add hundreds of billions of euros to the European economy and generate thousands of euros in extra annual income for the average European household. So the single market and economic reform in the member states is still key for economic growth, and even more so in the current context of fiscal constraints. For most member states, like say Italy or Spain in the current context, reforms aimed at improving the functioning of labour markets remain the prime and the pressing priority. In other words, increased labour mobility and wage flexibility are absolutely key to bringing people back into work and increasing productivity. And we should indeed embrace competition and structural change. The only protectionism we favour is that of protecting people. This means ensuring that all our citizens have the skills needed in a modern economy and society. In fact, spelling out what it takes to get growth going is not that difficult. But what is difficult is getting decisions done and implemented. And of course, many decisions are politically painful at first, and will take a long time to feel their full positive impact. But thankfully, we have several encouraging examples that show that restoring confidence in public finances and implementing ambitious structural reforms to boost growth do work. If you want examples, just have a look at Denmark and the Netherlands in the 1980s. Or since the 1980s, Finland and Sweden in the 1990s, and Germany in the first decade of the present century. In the current crisis, Estonia, Latvia, and Ireland have taken very bold decisions, measures of consolidation and reform, and there are now clear signs that these measures are indeed paying off. Dear friends, what I have just outlined is, in fact, a profoundly liberal agenda. That is a clear commitment to fiscal prudence and economic reform, while empowering individuals to use their potential in full with equal opportunities and social fairness. So, ladies and gentlemen, in this context, bringing down debt, it will take time. Similarly, structural reforms take often a long time, often several years, to give their full results. Markets, however, tend to be impatient, and this impatience can push solvent sovereigns or banking institutions into a liquidity crisis that could eventually endanger financial stability. And to avoid this, sufficient mechanisms to ensure the liquidity of member states and key financial institutions are necessary. Important decisions have been taken into this direction, for instance, leveraging the EFSF, bringing forward the permanent European stability mechanism, and good progress is being made on expanding the IMF resources as well. And we should also note the very significant steps taken by the European Central Bank to ensure the liquidity of the banking sector. The ECB actions are greatly contributing to stabilize our banking system. In this context, let me emphasize one very important point. Financial firewalls imply pooling risks among the member states. For this pooling, to be economically and politically feasible, strong mechanisms need to be in place to prevent free riding and moral hazard by any member state. In the case of the financial assistance from the EFSF, ESM, or the current mechanisms, very strict policy conditionality is the essential prerequisite for this. In the case of a wider pooling of sovereign risk through joint bonds, Eurobonds or stability bonds, strong governance mechanisms have to be created to prevent imprudent behavior. The Commission presented the Green Paper on stability bonds at the same time and in parallel with the proposals to further strengthen economic governance based on Article 136 of the Treaty on European Union. This was, of course, no coincidence. We see that the strengthening of governance and addressing the funding challenges in the euro area are intrinsically linked. They are very much intertwined. The six-pack, the proposals on 136 to reinforce economic governance further, and now the forthcoming fiscal compact treaty are all important steps into this direction. And here, let me underline the very basic principle to which at least I adhere to. And I trust, I hope you will agree with me. Any serious move in the further sharing of risk would have to be balanced by provisions that ensure sustainable public finances and minimize the moral hazard. Stability bonds, Eurobonds, would thus have to go in parallel, hand in hand, by a substantially reinforced fiscal surveillance and economic policy coordination as an essential counterpart of pooling the risk and creating these Eurobonds. Ladies and gentlemen, the joint issuance of member states' debt would fundamentally alter the structure of European financial markets. The potential advantages seem clear and large. Joint bonds would act as a driver of integration and efficiency of European bond markets. They could lower transaction costs and the cost of government borrowing. Stability bonds would strengthen financial stability by allowing member states a secure and stable access to refinancing, and lower debt servicing costs would give member states the time and the necessary breathing space for economic reform and fiscal consolidation. In short, stability bonds can provide substantial benefits also for countries with currently high credit standing. Yet there are serious challenges to make them work, both economic and legal challenges, as well as more technical ones. And we need to be clear about these as well. Some points on this. First and foremost, stability bonds should not lead to a reduction in budgetary discipline. An unlimited ability to borrow on capital markets with the help of credibility of other member states would weaken incentives for responsible fiscal behavior unless this was ensured by a rock-solid rules-based economic governance. Furthermore, stability bonds must be very safe and reliable instruments. Otherwise, they would lack market acceptance and political credibility in all member states. And finally, stability bonds must be consistent with the Treaty on European Union. Now, our Green Paper presents three broad, rather generic approaches to a possible design of stability bonds or Eurobonds. And they are based on two basic features. First, the degree of substitution of national issuance, which can be either full or partial, and second, the nature of the underlying guarantee of these bonds. The first option would be equivalent to a full substitution of euro area government bonds issuance by the stability bond. Such bonds would be backed by common guarantees, joint and several guarantees provided by all euro area member states together. This option would be or would very effectively deliver the benefits of a common bond. A very large, homogeneous and liquid bond market would very likely emerge, providing the global financial system a safe haven comparable to the US Treasury market. The new bond would serve as high quality collateral and improve the resilience of the euro area financial system. Yet, as I said before, but I want to underline this, this approach would need to be accompanied by very robust budgetary discipline, requiring significantly deeper economic, financial and also political integration. It is also very likely that bonds with joint and several guarantees would not be compatible with the Article 125 of the current treaty, i.e. that would imply or require treaty revision. Under the second approach, Eurobonds would also benefit from joint and several guarantees, but they would replace only a certain part of national debt financing, and as a result, the euro area government bond market would consist of two parts, stability bonds, for instance, up to a certain percentage of GDP, and national bonds issued at the national level under national guarantee. That's the famous blue bond, red bond proposal. And finally, the third option would be a partial substitution of national issuance by stability bonds backed with several but not joint guarantees. The difference between this approach and the other ones is that member states would remain liable for their respective share of stability bond issuance as well as for their national issuance. And this option is thus, in fact, an extension of the current EFSF financial backstop for regular financing of the sovereigns of the euro area. Of course, the risk of moral hazard in this third option would be much lower, as member states could not benefit from a possibly higher credit quality of other member states. Moreover, interest rates on national issuance would serve as a disciplining tool, and stability bonds based on this approach could be more rapidly deployable, could deliver advantages in terms of more secure access to funding, and could facilitate the conduct of monetary policy. However, let's be honest, this approach would obviously deliver much fewer benefits in terms of financial market efficiency and stability. The yield advantage would be substantially lower than in the case of issuance backed with the joint and several guarantees, as the credit quality of the issuance would at best be the weighted average of the credit qualities of the euro area member states. And furthermore, without significant further credit enhancement, such a bond might be very difficult to sell to capital markets. So, dear friends, as I have already stressed before, the Green Paper aimed at opening the debate on stability bonds. I think it has done that. Our event today is a very good example of such debate, which is essential in order to reflect appropriate further steps. We are still evaluating the feedback that we have received in our public consultation, which ended just a few days ago. And we have very carefully listened to various proposals for enhanced stability tools made over the past weeks or months. I only want to mention one which is highly relevant to this panel and this seminar. This includes the proposal made by the German Council of Economic Advisors, who Professor Smith and Mr. Weigert may correct me later on, suggest a joint issuance of bonds which would be limited in time and size to bring public debt in all member states to below 60% of their GDP. While I would not want to mix this with Eurobonds proper, I find the proposal smart and potentially doable and certainly worth exploring further. So, dear friends, let me sum up. I believe that at this juncture of the global economy and the financial crisis, we must have a serious debate on how to further develop and govern the economic and monetary union. The debate launched by the Green Paper on stability bonds is a crucial part of this perspective. If we can, as I trust, we can discuss dispassionately and decide responsibly, the potential gain is very concrete and tangible for all of us. Sounder economic policies across Europe, more integration of financial markets, and economic and financial stability for our economies at large. And all these qualities are indeed the very foundation for sustainable growth, job creation, and improved welfare. It won't be easy to achieve this, but it is definitely possible, and I trust that European Liberals and Democrats and the ALDE Group are actively part of this common challenge. With these thoughts, let me wish you all a very happy New Year. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Olli. I suggest that now we enter the Q&A phase, so please raise your hand and please present yourself or introduce yourself before you take the floor. I really want to thank the colleagues from other groups, and even if you have put everything under the umbrella of the Liberals, I'm very happy that colleagues from the other groups are present and they can feel free to intervene, of course. Marianne.
Thank you, and thank you to the Commissioner. I know that this discussion today is about Eurobonds, and therefore my intervention, I'll make it very short because it deals more with what the Commissioner spoke about, different countries and how fiscal consolidation worked in those countries. And you mentioned Finland and Sweden as good examples and others. And that's true, but you must, I think, recognize that they had fiscal instruments at their disposal that countries that within the Eurozone do not have at the moment. And one of the countries you mentioned where you said measures were paying off is Ireland, and I'm an Irish MEP. And what I would say to you, Commissioner, is yes, we do need to live within our means. We do need to balance our books. Our tax take collapsed when construction collapsed. But if you look to what was happening before that, we were within the Stability and Growth Pact. We were much better performers than either the French or the Germans or anybody else leading up to that point. Since then, unemployment is over 14%, and we have hundreds of thousands leaving a small country. Our GNP growth for the last 4 years continues to drop. Our exports in the last 5 months are well below the European average, which is absolutely the worst news we could expect to hear, way below Germany's, for example. Hundreds of businesses closing. So the point I'm making is our debt is expected to peak 2014. Our GDP is dropping. Our debt to GDP ratio is increasing. Yes, we have to live within our means, but how do we find a way out of this? And not just Ireland, there are other countries in this position. But you said specifically, and I quote, the measures are paying off. I would like to hear more from you about how those measures are paying off.
Lucas, qui vient du... comité des régions.
Thank you for the invitation to speak. I listened very carefully to what you said, Commissioner, and it strikes me that I live in a city, and there are many, many Europeans who live in cities and regions where the impact of austerity is being felt perhaps in a way that we had not envisaged. In my own city, for example, there has just been a report published which reckons that one in three households in that city are now without work. I want to follow on from what Miriam said, because I think she made a very, very good point. I want to ask two things. Firstly, how are we going to get growth back? Because austerity by itself is not going to do the job we need to have done. And if Eurobonds aren't going to be the accepted way forward in order to free some member states from the deep problems of sovereign debt that they have, what is the alternative? What happens then? Where do we go? How do we begin to get this requirement, this need, this hunger for growth back into the economic systems that we have created?
Thanks a lot. And a third question, perhaps, Commissioner, and then we merge the answers.
I'm Ana Gomes from Portugal, socialist. Yes, we are seeing in Portugal that indeed austerity is not delivering anything, namely growth and a strategy of creating jobs and wealth that would enable us indeed to pay the debt. We are at the same time watching this same strategy based on austerity leading us to sell strategic assets, and they're not just strategic for us, but they are strategic for Europe, namely to the Chinese. I just recall the sell of the EDP Portuguese company to a Chinese state company, the one that is being announced with the national straight grid to be possibly also the Chinese state bid grid company is also bidding for the Portuguese one. These are strategic assets. This is perverse, not just for possible Portugal, but also for Europe. Debt is growing. And jobs and support for the EU is dramatically being reduced among the public opinion. So I'd like to ask you, what are the reasons that those who have been opposing Eurobonds give you, Commissioner? Can we understand what is their reasoning? And how have you said that there's been indeed this new approach by the ECB to inject liquidity, but the results have not been seen because banks are not actually taking advantage of that, if not just to put the money back into the ECB? So how can indeed we tackle it if not through Eurobonds?
Thank you very much, Commissioner.
Thank you, Sylvie. Some of the questions are not so much focused on Eurobonds, but they are very relevant questions. So I will try to provide some response, some answer to these. First, to Madame Harken, as regards Ireland, you are fully right that in the case of Ireland, it was not only a fiscal crisis; it was in the first place a banking crisis, which then turned into a fiscal crisis. If I recall correctly, 4 or 5 years ago, the Irish public debt was around the level of 30% still. And in fact, this was the case in many other countries of the Eurozone as well. And the clearest fiscal crisis was mostly in Greece. In many other countries, it was a combination of, say, fiscal and competitiveness problems. And in the Irish case, especially a banking crisis. And this means that in order to prevent a crisis now and in the future, because the whole objective of the six-pack or the reinforcement of economic governance is that prevention is better than correction. Correction is extremely costly, both in economic terms and in human terms for ordinary people. So therefore, we have to create such kind of an architecture for the economic and monetary union that helps us to prevent such kind of crisis in the future. And that's why we should not only focus on fiscal policies or fiscal prudence, no matter how important that is, but we also have to look at macroeconomic imbalances in the euro area globally, and therefore the second pillar of the six-pack is indeed addressing and correcting macroeconomic imbalances. Now, tomorrow we will present proposals by the Commission. We will take and then present proposals or decisions concerning fiscal surveillance, especially of five countries that we warned 2 months ago in early November that their fiscal deficits may get out of hand in 2012. And then in 2 weeks' time, we will come back to the issue of excessive imbalances. And we are currently working in order to propose which countries for which reasons would be part of this exercise. I'm ready to come back to the ECON committee or whatever format of the parliament to discuss this once the work is a little bit more advanced. And then to the second question, which is related, in fact, to all three questions. How can we get growth? How can we get back to the track on economic growth, which indeed is the crucial issue? Now, we have to be analyzing the nature of the crisis very carefully and precisely, because, in fact, no amount of fiscal stimulus could solve the crisis unless we first solve the crisis of confidence, which is fundamentally eroding the foundations of economic growth and employment in Europe. And this crisis of confidence is essentially caused by a severely intertwined combination of sovereign debt crisis and banking sector fragilities. And that's why the sine qua non, the necessary condition of returning back to the path of economic growth is that we will be able to resolve the sovereign debt crisis and mitigate the banking sector problems, banking sector fragilities, so that there will be no credit crunch in the European economy. And that's the direction to which all the policy actions are now geared to in these days and in these weeks, so that we can finalize the work as regards the reinforcement of financial firewalls, of leveraging the EFSF and bringing forward the permanent European stability mechanism. And that's the direction where the member states are working in order to stabilize their own economies. And in this context, it is essential that as fiscal consolidation is a must, is a necessity, because you cannot solve a debt crisis by piling up further debt. That consolidation is done so that you ensure the quality of public finances. All the experience and all the cases I referred to in the past decades from Denmark and the Netherlands to Finland and Sweden and others, they're clearly the investment on education and innovation has been one of the crucial elements which has been protected even during the period of fiscal consolidation. And certainly structural reforms that help boost economic growth are even more essential than in normal times because the constraints on fiscal stimulus are so evident for everybody. This same story goes for Portugal as well, and in the Portuguese case, the EU IMF program is still relatively young, and Portugal has its own challenges, combination of loss of competitiveness and high level of private indebtedness. And now Portugal, together with the European Union and the IMF, is working in order to get out of this these problems and thus back on the path of sustainable growth and better employment.
Thank you, Olli. Louis-Michel.
Oui, d'abord, merci, Monsieur le Commissaire.
I'd like to start by thanking you, Commissioner, for your extremely interesting presentation. Perhaps I could make some comments. First of all, the crisis we're going through is primarily due to incorrect foundations of growth, growth based on excessive consumption and excessive use of credit. I don't think that we've paid sufficient attention to promoting effective investment designed to promote growth. That's my first point. My second point, I find it quite surprising to note that politicians from different political hues all seem to suddenly agree on the utility of Eurobonds. I think it might be wise for us to start by recognizing the difficulties inherent in this ideological agreement. I have heard clearly the arguments. I know that some people think that Eurobonds are a fairly easy, quick fix when it comes to doing away with excessive budgetary and economic rigor. If that's the case, we find ourselves in a bind, and that's my obvious view as a liberal. If Eurobonds provide us with new sources of funding, my view is that that money should primarily be used to restructure our aiding industries to help promote growth, sustainable jobs, and to enable Europe to catch up with the rest of the world. That's what we're actually talking about here. I think there has been an ideological and political agreement in the past. When we base our consumption and growth on credit, obviously that feeds into the most selfish side of capitalism. And this is an easy way out for politicians, who are then no longer obliged to tell their voters unpleasant and unpopular truths. And following the comments, the excellent comments made by Mrs. Gomez, I think we should start by verifying whether we all agree when it comes to the definition of austerity. Austerity, from my point of view, isn't the same as what the Belgian socialists called fair rigor. So fiscal rigor isn't necessarily austerity. Ultimately, austerity is unnecessary or pointless suffering, a form of masochism or sadism. This does actually exist, but I would like to ask you to clarify these points. If we expand on the idea of fiscal rigor, the initial and effective idea of this would also enable us to bring an end to these excesses, these morally reprehensible excesses, this sort of vulgar financialization of the economy. If we are to reconceptualize and redefine fiscal austerity, it would be a good thing, a good side effect, if we could bring an end to those excesses. My final point, we should talk about growth based on development and the need to overhaul our aging European manufacturing infrastructure. So, Commissioner, would it be possible for us to use part of the product of the Eurobonds to carry out selective investments? So, for example, we could help restructure some of the major industries in Europe which are lagging behind, the automotive sector, or, of course, energy, another sector of fundamental importance. Would it be conceivable that some of the money generated could be used to provide a fillip to growth? We could use this both to restructure certain major industrial sectors, while at the same time facing up to the future on more solid foundations. I hope I haven't been too lengthy in what I've said, but I think when it comes to Eurobonds, there is a risk of us misconceiving what's meant by this, and there's a very real risk that Eurobonds can actually have very negative consequences. If we support Eurobonds simply to enable politicians to shirk their responsibilities when it comes to explaining to the people of their country why we can't build a solid future while ignoring current responsibilities. Thank you, Louis. That's not the way that we've defined them anyway. Elisa Ferreira, who was actually rapporteur in the second pillar of the six pack, has asked for the floor. Thank you for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you very much. I think the question I'd like to put to the Commissioner is about the mixture of rigidity and control, and on the other hand, the need to have growth and convergence, without which the consolidation will be just a short-term measure. And in particular, I'd like to understand what is the reasoning of the Commission in relation to the duality of these two branches. Because we go on and on with six-pack, now with the two specific regulations, now with the mentioning permanently of the Europlus Pact. So we are moving in two directions. The first one is that we are focusing more and more on rigidity, on short-termism, and control of deficit and debt, which may be an unsustainable medium-term target and a contradictory trajectory in relation to the 2020 agenda, to the need for Europe to become again a big partner in the world economy. And secondly, I think we are moving more and more away from the community method that guarantees the equilibrium between different, very different, and more different states, and our common understanding of a common future. And this dual movement, I think it's becoming a very, very difficult issue. My last comment is about the reasoning and the conclusions that we have to take out of this crisis. And I think on one hand, it is becoming more and more clear that the architecture, the institutional architecture for the functioning of the common currency was not complete. There were missing links. And in particular, how to react to a crisis when you have different countries with different levels of development and different structures under the same common currency and divergences growing farther and farther apart inside Europe require some sort of common instrument to get out of crisis and to rebalance the issue. And we were missing it. Fortunately, the ECB made some moves, and the Commission, a bit later from my liking, but went on from the EFSF to the ESM, and things are moving. But we have got to understand there are missing links in the architecture of the common currency. And lastly, if we don't address growth in a worldwide context, not just internal market, but with an external commercial policy that is clear and understandable, and also internally, of course, with the internal market that has to take into account the differences, starting point differences between the different member states. If we don't address these two issues, we are probably just working on short-termism and not solving the issue. So I think the Eurobonds are part of this new way to look at the architecture, and I think we require them to safeguard the common currency from individual nationalistic attacks on specific speculative grounds on the different debt from different member states. It's a matter of survival, and we have got to go fast on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Elisa. I suggest I have a question from Theodoros and one from Andrew Duff. If the Commissioner does accept, we ask them, please be, if possible, not too long, and then the Commissioner will answer for this last row. Thank you.
Thank you, Sylvie. Thank you, Commissioner. I'll be very brief. Greece is obviously the case where the fiscal was the problem. But as we see today, the fiscal, we have gone beyond that. Now the confidence in the currency is the problem. At this moment, I'm not sure we are in or out of the euro. We have double the interest rates than in the euro area. So how and when can we restore confidence, let's say the wider confidence, and we'll see what will happen in Greece. Thank you.
Commissioner, what are we to make of the British? The British have said quite frequently
that there is a remorseless logic to fiscal union. But they also have stopped the necessary and desirable treaty reforms to put in place the first steps that you so correctly describe as being increased discipline towards making such a fiscal union possible. And given the circumstances which we find ourselves in, what is the Commission going to do next?
If I may, I must apologize. I've forgotten someone I don't want to forget, which is Sophie, the very last one, and I know she's going to be short.
Yeah, I'm easily overlooked. No, very, very briefly, I think you're right when you say that Eurobonds are an element of the total package that is a solution. I think the colleagues who said that austerity in itself is not enough to bring growth are also right, but I also think that even, and I very much agree with Louis Michel, not even investment in itself is enough. And you spoke of moral hazard. Maybe we should rather speak of solidarity or joint responsibility for growth, because there is one element missing, and that is the urgent need for structural reforms. I think you were the only one who mentioned it, because we can invest until we drop, but unless we radically reform the labor market, unless we accept the fact that we simply have to work longer until retirement, you know, unless we are willing to really create this internal market and eliminate all the barriers, we can invest as much as we like, but we're not going to spend our way towards growth. And how it's easy to find rules to impose fiscal prudence, but it's not so easy to convince people that they have to accept these unpopular and yet necessary reforms. And I think they are an essential pillar of the whole package.
Thank you. In fact, Sophie pointed out a very important issue which is part of the debate, and it is that in many member states, where the citizens have had some doubts whether they should support the rescue packages, this has precisely been an issue because they feel that they have had the political pain of going through the structural reforms and they need to then contribute to the rescue packages of other countries that have not done the same fiscal effort or structural reforms. I think it is not necessarily as simple as that, but this has to be kept in mind, and therefore it is crucial that we see that there is not only solidarity or not only responsibility. You have to carry the both. You have to carry both tracks, both dimensions, and bring them as part of the overall grand bargain how Europe can overcome the current sovereign debt crisis. We need both. Responsibility in terms of fiscal prudence and structural reforms in order to boost economic growth in a sustainable manner. And we need stability instruments that provide the breathing space for the countries that are undertaking this fiscal effort and economic reform. And of course, the ultimate aim in that regard is then convergence, so that we have a more and more level playing field, not only in the single market, but also in other areas of economic and fiscal policy making. As regards other questions, Louis Michel had very interesting and important reflections on the nature of growth and role of investment there. Just in order to save time and so that we can move on in the panel discussion, I will be very brief. I'd say that as regards productive investment. I mean, not say sovereign bonds, but productive investment. Our recent proposal on project bonds, EU 2020 project bonds, it's a very important initiative, and I'm very glad that the European Parliament has endorsed this initiative. Why is it important? Again, because we have such fiscal constraints as we have. We cannot expect that in the coming years there will be huge sums of public money into, say, cross-border investment on energy, transport, or communications. And therefore, we need to match this with private money, private investment, and the project bond is a credible method of creating a public-private partnership at the European level, which should be in particular focused on cross-border investment on infrastructure in the areas of energy, transport, and communications. I hope that we can start the pilot phase shortly, so that in the next multi-annual financial framework, we would have this in full speed, and it could contribute to economic growth and job creation in Europe. As regards the reflection on rigor versus austerity, which Louis did, and in a way Elisa Ferreira as well, I must say that as you think of rigor and austerity, without going into linguistics or linguistic acrobatics, I must say that I do not like the word austerity, but I'm very much in favor of the word rigor. Why is this important? If you have two countries, one country which is reckless in its fiscal policy, one country which is rigorous in its fiscal policy, I'm certain that the country that is rigorous and can practice kind of consistent reform and consistent rigor in its fiscal policy making is much better in avoiding lengthy periods of austerity, which are so painful for our citizens. And therefore, what we need is that we have to improve our euro area economic governance so that we recall that prevention is always better than correction. And that's why, for instance, tomorrow's decisions, and as Louis posed this question, the decisions in the recent days in the Belgian government have been so important, which have been influenced by the six-pack and the requirements of fiscal rigor in the six-pack. I fully agree with Elisa Ferreira that the community method is the method that makes the Union, European Union, work and deliver. And that's why we have to be together very careful that the negotiations on the new fiscal compact will not lead us away from the community method. I think we have very good chances of that, not least because a big part, in fact, most part, 95% of the substance of the new fiscal treaty, fiscal compact treaty, or whatever it will be called in the end, 95% of it can be done through secondary legislation. Most of it is already there because of the six-pack, thanks to the six-pack. We made further proposals in November to further enforce this, and we are ready to make even additional proposals within the frame of the current treaty framework. There are only mainly two issues which require an intergovernmental agreement. One is this constitutional debt brake, and the other one is the automatic sanctions unless there is a revision of Article 126 defining fiscal policy. And Theodoros referred to Greece, and I've been quite intensively working on Greece again today before coming here after leaving this panel discussion, and we are about to finalize shortly the negotiations on private sector involvement, which is a necessary condition of moving forward on the on the second programme, negotiations on the second programme. And we work together with the ECB and the IMF in order to negotiate with the Greek government a second programme that will ensure sustainability of public finances and will reinforce economic growth in Greece, which is the fundamental issue for the country and for its future. It is not going to be easy. It is very challenging, but I'm reasonably confident that we will achieve this aim, and we will thus continue to support the Greek people in order to overcome their current difficulties and reform their economy and their society so that it is meeting the requirements of Eurozone membership. And finally, to Andrew, it's a very difficult question you pose, not so difficult for me, but rather in general, because the UK has several times stated, as you referred to, the remorseless logic of an economic and monetary union, that there is a need of further economic integration. So the new treaty aims at further fiscal and economic integration and helping in order to solve the Eurozone sovereign debt crisis. So it is essentially fully in line with the objectives of the UK government. So therefore, I have some difficulties to see why we should then trade something for Britain if we are in any case aiming at the same goals and objectives as the UK government is doing. Having said that, I think there is plenty of spilled milk. Let's look to the future. And we have been advocating to bring the UK fully to participate in the talks on the new fiscal compact. That has happened. I'm very satisfied with that. And I look forward to working with the United Kingdom so that we do everything that is possible in the context of EU 27, while we do only the euro area specific fiscal issues if needed in the context of euro area 17 and in the context of this new fiscal compact. And I must say that I have difficulties to understand why there is still some continuing British French spat or media wrangling, especially since yesterday evening, as Thierry Henry scored such a beautiful goal for Arsenal, which is managed by Arsene Wenger. The little Englanders, Arsene Wenger and Thierry Henry, saved Arsenal once again. I'm Man United, but with due respect to Arsenal and Thierry Henry.
Thank you, Mr. Commissioner, for all this. I suggest that we now move to the second part of our event and that we give the floor to the other speakers. But thank you very much for your contribution, for your work. And I suggest that Mr. Schmidt takes the floor. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I'm very grateful for the invitation. Let me say that also on behalf of of Dr. Weigert, the General Secretary of the Council of Economic Experts, who is accompanying me today. We are especially grateful to be invited to this session because it's a session on Eurobonds. And our proposal is not a proposal on Eurobonds proper, as the Commissioner said, and the Commission in its green paper insightfully also discussed our proposal. I'm sorry about that, discussed our proposal, but insightfully said it's not Eurobonds, and it's true, especially as it will become clear, I think, during the next few minutes to those who are not too familiar with the proposal, especially since it's time-limited. Time-limited here means 20 to 25 years, which is a long time to go, but it's still time-limited.
In politics, it's eternity, yeah?
It might be so, it might be so, but it's reflecting long-term problems, a long-term build-up of problems, and you can't really solve a problem that has built up for decades within a few minutes, and that's basically, or even years, and that's basically a reflection on that. Before I enter discussing the proposal. Let me just stress or emphasize, if I may, that we are an independent council. I'm not able to speak, fortunately or unfortunately, that decision is to be made, but I'm not able to speak for the German government. We are not a council of economic advisors, as you would have it in, for example, the United States. We are just an independent council of experts required to write an annual report on the state of the German economy in its, as it is evolving in Europe, in the world, in the world economy. And this year we wrote our report in November 2011. We published it under the heading of taking or assuming responsibility for Europe. And here we address, or in our work, we address European topics or topics of European relevance in several domains. For example, energy policy, which doesn't really interest us today. But it's not only about the European debt crisis, but that's actually what really has constructed our whole year of conversations, discussions of economic reasoning, the euro debt crisis. And reflecting that, and that's why I would like to move to the first slide, please. Reflecting that, we have devoted a lot of attention to this issue. Now, let me say in the beginning that our overarching sentiment in discussing that issue is that EMU is something really worth fighting for. Back to, as you might, if you follow the German press or several other newspapers around Europe, I guess, but especially some of the German press and some opinions voiced by German economists, you might get the impression that one or the other might think that it's easy to go back to a situation where monetary policies are national endeavors, where Europe is not as integrated as it has become in the decades up to now. And that's something that the Council of Economic Experts really very seriously rejects as a good opinion, a good idea. We really think that we should do everything possible and everything achievable to try to save the European Economic and Monetary Union. Now, the slide shows you something that has become very familiar to you, to all of us, within the last 2 years or so. Namely, the sovereign yield spreads in Europe. And you see what is unfortunately the case is that in the most recent period, there's an upturn again. So our motivation to really seriously discuss something like this European Redemption Pact that I'm just trying to outline today, our motivation was that we are reaching, or we have reached something like an impasse between those advocating long-term stability, and the commissioner very clearly said that this is an important issue also for those proposing Eurobonds. So don't mistake me to somehow insinuate that being for or against Eurobonds is taking position as to moral hazard issues. I'm not saying that. But nevertheless, those who are concerned about long-term stability usually emphasize moral hazard issues, and preventing moral hazard is something that is of high importance. But of course, only saying we have to have a construction or a system that is preventing moral hazard in the long term doesn't help us out of the crisis. On the other hand, there are many people who would emphasize in the moment that solidarity is all the issue, that trying to get out of the crisis at all cost and with all means would be the imperative thing to do. But on the other hand, there are many proposals floating around that might solve the short-term crisis but generate problems in the long term. And within this impasse of positions, we are trying to build a bridge. That's basically, I think, one of the major assets of our proposal, that we are trying to build a bridge reaching between factions that might otherwise not come together in their opinions, trying to break this impasse. And in setting up our proposal, we tried to do two things. One thing is, of course, and there you are the judge, the intellectual basis of such a proposal has to be convincing. The pieces have to fit together, and it has to make sense, and it has to be workable. But what is even more important is that in this particularly sensitive situation, you have also to be very convincing to those who are the most critical. And of course, we are talking about institutions like the German Constitutional Court, which is a very important, and if you ask me, a very needed corrective to many things that are decided or might be decided upon in the policy sphere. It's good that we have such a corrective, such as the German Constitutional Court, but it sets some confines, or within the confines of the possibilities set by its decisions, this workable or this proposal has to be workable. Otherwise, we are proposing something that will not fly. So our setup was, of course, addressed mainly to the German government and mainly to the German public, but we meant it to be a very European affair, and we try, as I said, to build a bridge of sorts. May I have the second slide, please? Well, how does the European Redemption Pact work? I'm sorry, I have a bit of a cold. I have to apologize. Well, the first aspect is that we are taking the 60% threshold very seriously, that we are talking about and that we have promising ourselves so much in the past, that we take very seriously, and we say, well, let's take all debts above the Maastricht, this Maastricht reference of 60%, and transfer it to a common fund, to a so-called, by accident, called redemption fund, which is subject to joint and several liability. So here is some clear resemblance to Eurobond ideas, but that's only one aspect of it. So let's put it, transfer these amounts country by country, but only for those countries which are not in an adjustment program at the time being. Let's take that debt and transfer it to a common redemption fund. You see already two elements there. One is we are trying to, at the same time as we try to propose something resolving the crisis, we are trying to propose something that addresses the root cause or one root cause of the problem. I think it was already in the discussion today, and we are agreeing that there are several causes to the current crisis. One is the debt built up so up to the crisis or to the financial crisis, and the other one is, as you indicated, is of course the many measures taken to prevent the crisis from even having more or exerting more damages. Anyway, we are trying to address the root, one of the root causes, namely debt. And at the same time, we are trying to be preventive, because all the approaches so far taken under the EFSF heading and so forth are, of course, reactions, not prevention of problems building up into serious problems. So there are costs involved. We are trying to balance the cost for all sides, those who are giving more and those who are in need of solidarity, because each country individually would be obligated to autonomously redeem the transferred debt, that's why it's a redemption fund, over a period that seems reasonable. Reasonable means here 20 to 25 years. So one or the other in the person in the room will have one or the other gray hair by the time that the redemption fund will dissolve itself, that's clear. But as I said, it's a long-term problem that we are trying to address together, and our proposal therefore has to have a long-term, if you say even infinite, but a long-term time horizon of 20 to 25 years. And that's basically something that reminds us immediately of the Stability and Growth Pact, because there we are talking about 1/20th of the amount over 60% that we would like to reduce annually. The second aspect that refers to the pain that this redemption fund is, of course, holding in stock for each participating country, if you feel that it's a pain, is to introduce a national debt brake. Because if you take out the debt or transfer the debt beyond, over and above 60%, of course you have to ensure that the 60% threshold is not broken again by the rest not transferred to the fund. So that's clearly a prerequisite that has to be part of the proposal from our point of view. On the other hand, it gives a lot, this idea, because it gives a lot to those countries who are running large deficits in the moment, are experiencing or are fearing to experience refinancing problems, because the low refinancing costs, we cannot really say how low exactly, but it's quite obvious that there's a good chance that the refinancing cost of the fund are lower than those countries are experiencing in the moment. That's basically another resemblance to the idea of Eurobonds, because this idea of pooling risks and therefore being more liquid and enjoying lower refinancing costs is the same. May I have the second slide? Next slide, please. Here you see the whole animal in operation. This is the redemption fund in our view if it's filled completely. And you see it's not really an innocuous affair. It's quite a large fund. It's about 2.3 trillion euro. No, it's not billion. I have to be careful here. Trillion euro. And you see that there are some big players. And there are some big players, and it's clear that if some of these big players don't participate, the whole idea cannot fly. If just, let's say, just for the sake of argument, if just Italy would take, please, I apologize if it's too obvious, but if just Italy, let's say, and Belgium and Spain would pool, that would not really do the trick. France and Germany, of course, are important here. Especially Germany as the second largest participant in this fund is important. You see that Italy would be accounting for not quite half, but almost for 1 trillion euro in this fund. Germany would be accounting for almost 600 billion. So this would be if it would be fully filled. But as we see in the second slide from now, as we will see, there is something like a roll-in phase, which is very important. But let me just stress for one more time the conditions of participation, or detail them a little bit more. I talked already about the debt breaks and about its acquaintance, its close association with the Stability and Growth Pact. And of course, a topic that has been discussed with the Commissioner during the last few minutes very intensely is also a part of this. This can only work if there's a fiscal consolidation strategy together with a structural reform agenda. We did not spell out the structural reform agenda country by country among the potential participants, in our report, but it's clear that the elements of such a structural reform agenda are very much the same that were mentioned from the floor in your contribution, for example. Of course, there's a lot that has to be done to be on a growth path again. Just getting the refinancing part straight and not doing something on the growth part would not do the trick. Of course, as it is not one root cause causing the problem, there can't be just one element of resolution to solve the problem. And the idea that we put forward in our report is something like, in addition to following the structural debt as a percentage of GDP, you should also look at expenditure paths, try to solid there, and maybe if expenditures are rising too fast, require yourself or bind yourself, tie yourself to a scheme where you increase a certain tax in order to get in the range of a decent deficit. Well, that's only the economic part. One important aspect is that we would build in another safety valve, the safety valve being the pledge of part of the national currency reserves in foreign currency, in gold. We are not really absolutely specific about that, but there should be some pledge to cover the individual liabilities. And we have been mistaken in German commentaries sometimes within the last few weeks that we would like to pool the currency reserves. There's no idea about that. I mean, Italy would be responsible for its 900 and something billion euro, Germany for its almost 600 and so on, and the pledge would be to cover these liabilities country by country. But nevertheless, that's something that basically requires a lot from the individual participants. That's something that you would not decide about easily in front of your national voters, I guess. And of course, another very important element is that national tax revenues should be earmarked for the redemption. And of course, we are not, I mean, everything is under, is something that you would spell out more concretely, more specifically in the discussions about its specific setup. But it's clear that if these conditions are not met, there should be something like, at least in the initial years, an exit out of the whole scheme. And that's why we have, and that's the next slide, please, that's why we have in a roll-in phase, of, say, 4 to 5 years. One of the ideas or behind that is clear. The critics of this proposal would always argue, well, you take the debt amount over 60%, transfer it to the fund, and if you start then negotiating and trying whether all participants are really adhering to the promises that they make, that's too late, then the damage is done and you can't reverse the whole process. That's something we would like to try to prevent by having 4 or 5 years of a roll-in where the next refinancing years for the countries in question are organized via the fund until the now at the time being fixed amount of transferable funds is met. And of course, this means that in the meantime, within the next 4 or 5 years, the illiquidity issues that we are currently facing, that for example are discussed in the context of Italy or Spain or other countries, would be out of the question because it would be refinancing via the fund, which should allow low refinancing rates to be realized. And of course, during that time, the participating countries would have to prove their seriousness about affairs. They would have to reduce their structural deficits. They would have to set up their growth strategies. And they would have time to do so because the illiquidity issues, the liquidity problems are out of the, the discussion. And that means, of course, at least that's our idea about this, that you separate the two aspects that are intertwined, that are entangled in the current debate, namely long-term problems, structural problems on the one hand, and liquidity problems on the other. So we will all have time to look to the future and see how it might be structured, whether there will be Eurobonds, or there will be a return to the old idea of national responsibility, is not part of our proposal. Our proposal gives us breathing space, gives us time, and I think that's why the Green Paper also is so positive about it. Yeah. Let me just jump ahead 2 slides, please, and then I'm almost finished. And you see, for an example for Italy, on the left-hand part of the slide, you see the light part, the yellow part, that's the part of debt that is transferred. You see that Italy is starting in the moment, and I apologize if we just take this example, but it's nice to draw, let's say. Yeah, it's no. I hope everybody is agrees on taking Italy as an example. There could be other examples like Germany, France, Spain, whatever. You see that we start with 120%, and it's all national responsibility, and we would like to transfer the part over the horizontal line, the 60% line, and we do that over the first 5 years, and then the solid line from above shows you the path towards 60%, which would be reached within about 25 years. Now, there are some simulations that we could talk about, but I skipped them because of the time. Show you the next slide, and here you see just briefly, I don't really go into the details. If you like, we can do that later on. You see how the fund would build up to be in full form at the year 2016, and then would dissolve itself. So you can, if you followed our idea and everything worked out as we envisaged it, you would lock it up 2035, and it would be history. Last slide, just to reiterate the few points that I tried to make. It would be a preventive approach. It would focus on long-term consolidation, on debt reduction, and therefore at the root cause of the problems, but it would also allow breathing space, a backloaded fiscal consolidation, and if you like, it would be something like a temporary Eurobond, But that would open up the field for thorough and considerate and emotionally disattached discussion about the issue, different from the eye of the storm in which we are in the moment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Vielen Dank. Je voudrais passer la parole à...
Thank you. I'll give the floor to Jacques Delplon, who I think would like to react and has his own proposal, but perhaps he can come back on that idea put forward once the red and blue bonds put forward by Delplon and Feisecker. Yes, thank you for coming to listen to us. Thank you to Guy Verhofstadt and Sylvie Goulard for inviting us to speak. I'm going to talk about the Franco-German initiative. It simply involves a French and German economist, but in English.
Bond 2.0, that's the first time in public. We have published a well-known paper on Blue Bond, the first generation of ID. We have received a lot of comments, so we have tried to move forward and to put on the table a more acceptable approach, especially for our friends in Northern Europe, including Germany, Finland, Austria, and the like. So, I would like to. So I have 3 points in my presentation. It will be very quick because I have too many slides. The first, I will remind what is our original idea about blue bond and red bonds, because there are many errors about the interpretation of our paper. The second, I will give you the flavor of our blue bonds 2.0. What are the improvements compared to the first idea? And if I have time, how we move the transition from now to Blue Bond 2.0, and I will be happy after to discuss the redemption fund, which I think is a very good idea on the table, even though I have some important remarks about it. So, what was our original idea? Hello. Yeah. Our original idea was first to create liquidity. You have to be in financial market to understand that European government debt are not liquid. Even the German Bund is not liquid. So the idea, as Prime Minister Verhofstadt said, is to create an alternative to the US Treasury bond market. At the moment, the whole world, except the G7, is in search of safe assets. Banks worldwide are in search of safe assets. Pension funds, sovereign wealth funds, central banks, and we are in Europe letting this privilege to the US. I remember that Jacques Rueff and Valéry Giscard d'Estaing in 1964 or 65 criticized le privilège exorbitant du dollar, the exorbitant privilege of the US dollar. So I'm not at all anti-American, but I want to challenge the US dollar dominance in the bond market. So that's the first idea of the blue bond. The second idea is about fiscal incentive. Both my colleague Jakob von Weizsäcker, who could not be here, and myself, we are fiscal hawks. So our proposal for blue bonds is not at all a credit line for lazy people to spend money and for that money to be paid by hardworking northern people. We are delivering a proposal which, in our view, is much more orthodox in terms of fiscal policy because there are sticks and carrots, because the incentives are extremely credible. So you know the general design of our proposal is to divide all debt, all sovereign debt in two. One part would be what we call blue is senior, is extremely strong, cannot go above 60% of GDP. And even if you take Greek sovereign debt, even the first 60% of GDP could be AAA. I don't want to make the demonstration, but when you take the data about Greece, you need to have debt service to be below 10% of general government revenues to be clearly in the AAA area. The US government is now at 15%, 1.5. If you take the Greek debt, only the, what we could call the blue debt in Greece, the debt service would be 7.5% of the total government revenues. So even Greek, the worst case scenario, could qualify for blue. So that's the first thing. Can I, the second thing is that, of course, that's the amount in terms of billion. And the amount in terms of billion is, of course, it would be by and large Italy, Spain, and France. Italy, Germany, and Spain. Italy, Germany, and France with the largest red debt. So the general design is, once again, blue bond is a common euro. It's super safe. The idea is to make the blue bond in each country as good as bond or even better. It would be issued with extremely tough conditions to enter it, while the red debt would be the opposite, would be defaultable, would be national, and would take all the losses. Once again, we are not creating an easy way for people not to reform themselves and not to have a fiscal rigor. There is one very strong theorem in economics, which is a Modigliani-Miller theorem, that whatever you tranche or you structure your capital, the aggregate risk is the same. So if the blue debt is extremely strong, then the red debt is extremely weak. So once again, the blue debt is a senior in every country. It's 4A, it's better than 3A, AAA. It's quadruple A, why? Because there is no rating migration risk. If you had bought Irish bond in 2006, it was AAA. If you had bought a 20-year Irish bond in 2005, it was AAA, and probably in 15 years' time, it might be bankrupt or whatever, it is in bad shape. Or you can, so because there is no risk of a rating migration, we consider our proposal as 4A. No risk of not being AAA, which is important at the moment because of the discussion with the rating agency. Hello. So the interest rate, because the quality of the debt would be as good as bond, it normally it should be, and because there is no rating migration risk, it should be along the AAA area. As good as bond, and because of the international liquidity premium, we expect the rates on this blue debt to be lower than the German bond Ceteris Paribus, of course. On the other side, the red debt would be, the interest rates on the US federal debt is much lower than in California, which is the strongest in terms of GDP or whichever state you take in the US. On the other side, of course, red debt would be junior, national, could be defaulted. Banks should not be allowed to hold red debt to avoid the systemic effect. You know, we don't want to have banks knocking on the door of the government and the commission and telling us, you know, we have a bomb in our vault, so you have to bail us out, or otherwise you explode with us. So that's why banks should hold only blue debt for their, all their buffer and the like. The blue debt governance, our proposal is purely intergovernmental. Personally, I'm a really pro-European federalist, but a federal debt will not happen probably in my lifetime because we are all different and because the budget and the debt is at the heart of a national sovereignty. So our proposal is purely intergovernmental. Every country can join, every country can move out, and nobody is locked forever for the new debt. So you have access only to blue debt if you abide by the European rules, by the Stability Pact, the new Stability Pact, the new Stability Pact. The allocation of blue debt is only for 1 year, so it has to be renewed every year. So it's not a blank check for the rest of the eternity. So it's just like when you vote a guarantee for the IMF or the World Bank. That's why I believe it doesn't need any change in the national constitution, be it Germany, France, or whatever. It's not a federal debt. It's not something where you give away the key for the eternity. So there would be a proposal for blue debt allocation every year done by either the European Commission or the blue debt committee nominated by the EU Council. And really, you would have access to blue debt only if you comply with orthodox, which, by the way, means that every country, including Germany, or especially Germany, can make a huge amount of effort, of pressure to be sure that fiscal rule will be followed. Our proposal is meant to avoid the 3 o'clock in the morning on Sunday night agreement between some head of states who may not have seen all the consequences of what they signed, you know, and then they go back to the parliament and say, oh God, you have to vote that, you know. Here, it's a continued process, and Mrs. Merkel, Mr. Sarkozy, and their followers could always hide before their own parliament to say I cannot. The other thing is that it's not nuclear in the sense that it's now 0-1. We don't know how to say 0 or 1 in Europe. So you can give blue debt partially or totally. So what is the second version? The blue debt is more safe, even more safe, which is what I call more blue. And the red debt is even weaker, which is I call more red. So the new feature would be stronger in the sense that I think there should be a blue treaty, which would be intergovernmental, which defines seniority, which enshrines in a treaty that the blue debt would never go above 60% of GDP. Once again, it's a hedge against the 3 o'clock in the morning Brussels syndrome. So head of government would be unable, or ministers of finance, to say, by the way, today we think we have to go above 60%. With that, you would have to change completely the blue treaty, which would probably take many years and which would give a veto for many parliaments. The second thing is that any country would not be allowed to issue senior debt outside of the blue debt mechanism. And if you issued other debt, you issue in red, which is extremely expensive. Collateral. I mean, it was discussed by our German colleague. I mean, our idea is to have a wall of assets against the wall of debt. If you share with France, Germany, Italy, whoever, your responsibility, joint and several responsibility for debt, you have to put somehow collateral. And our idea is the collateral is a possible grab taxation on national capital, which is national capital is 2/3 of housing stock and 1/3 financial assets. What I said about the blue debt default, it's only, I mean, we can only imagine a country defaulting in case of a massive natural disaster. And I'm sure that if one country suffered a natural disaster, it would help in any case. And the new feature on red debt is that it's we don't go to the bankruptcy case. In Europe, we are unable to put a large bank in bankruptcy. So the idea is to have debt like airbags in cars, which absorb losses without going to the default event. So the red debt would be what is called in financial terms COCO, contingent convertible. And how would it work? We go to the, what would be the feature of the COCO debt? Basically, it would pay coupons normally, but in case you go to the IMF rescue case or EU rescue ESM fund, then automatically, by the same token, the red debt would absorb losses like airbag. It would absorb loss with the coupon will not be paid for the 3 years of the program, and the principal of the debt would be extended automatically. So if you had bought a 10-year debt for a country with problems, if at 5 years you have the country goes to the IMF, you lose 3 years of coupons plus the fact that the capital is forward by 3 years. So it's a huge loss. Depending on the interest rate, it can be a loss of net present value between 20 and 40% of the NPV. So it's enormous. So once again, the idea that blue debt, there would be no liquidity problem, because at the moment in Europe, we have contagion. And that's my difference with the redemption fund. The redemption fund says about nothing about contagion effects. With the blue debt, there's no contagion effect because there's a complete and very strong joint and several liability. In the red debt, there's no problem of contagion because once you go to the IMF, you don't have to roll over this junk debt. So once again, the red debt, I'm going to conclude very, very quickly. Maybe that's for our German friends. Maybe some people are against Eurobonds, and I hear that in the public, in the European public debate. But there is no way we can keep on the euro without common European debt. Because at the moment, what is happening is that we have a self-fulfilling crisis, which is not going to end very soon, because there is a massive confidence crisis. And what is happening is that all the Mediterranean countries' saving is going to Holland, Germany, or Finland, with negative interest rate in German debt, and with interest rate at sky-high levels in Italy. So we may think that they've done a bad job in the past in the south, which is probably true. But the fact that Germany can finance itself with a negative interest rate or 1.8% at 10 years, and Italy is at 7%, means that if we don't have a common debt, the euro is dead. Our proposal, I don't believe in a complete federal debt, because I think the political debate is not in terms of federation. So our proposal has many benefits. It creates a common pool debt, allowing the South to keep being in the euro. It provides all the incentives. And once again, what struck me when we designed the whole thing, my German colleague told me that I was really too German because there were too many requirements. And I was expecting a very tough resistance from southern countries on our proposal. So that's why it was very strange. It was the opposite. I think that's all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Il y a des questions. J'ai vu Monsieur Kreutzmann, etc.
We got any questions? I've seen Mr. Kreutzmann and so on, but I think we should probably give the floor to Jean-François Robin, who's got another proposal for you, so then you get the full spectrum. Thanks again for coming.
Okay, thank you. So I'll try to put forward our proposition, but most of all, I'll try maybe to give you some color from the market side. I'm a strategist, so I'm working in a dealing room, and I'm visiting lots of, if not most of the central banks and the sovereign wealth funds in the world. And what I'm trying to give you is some colors on what we are looking at and why we need, in our view, something, which be it a redemption bond, a blue bond, red bond, or the solution we have at Natixis, whatever. The most important thing is to move towards something more towards more federalist approach or towards some kind of common bonds. As the commissioner said, we are in a deep crisis of confidence in the euro. Investors worldwide, in our view, are more and more reluctant to finance non-domestic debts. In the eurozone, investors do not want to finance non-domestic debt. a French one do not want to finance any more Italian through BTPs, and outside Eurozone, less and less investors are looking at Euro national debt, as I said, except Germany. So it's something of a big trouble in our views. That's the start of not the deconstruction of the Eurozone, but clearly we are losing an asset of the Eurozone, which was the financing, the common financing of Euro previously. Italian or Irish are doing the job of reforming. Italian are attacking the job of not rigor, but not austerity, but rigor, as if I understood well, and reforms. But even with that, Italian BTPs are at 7-13% today. That's way above sustainable level, so it's not working in itself. So we have to move on towards something more ambitious in the market view, we think. We have to move towards, Jack said, towards an alternative to the US dollar. There is no question. There is enough liquidity worldwide. There is enough liquidity in the Eurozone. There is no question about that. What the investor needs, it's a high quality, predictable, homogeneous debt, which is reflecting the Eurozone as a whole. If we look at the Eurozone as a whole, if you take deficit, if you take public debt, if you take a current account balance, if even you take employment, you come up with the conclusion that Eurozone as a whole is doing better than the US, much better than the US. So there is no reason with a euro bond we can attract some investors, but clearly something the national debt are not able to do anymore, apart from Germany at the moment. Clearly, what we get now is some contagion. From last year, the correlation have totally changed. Now there is Germany and Finland, but among liquid debt, only Germany, to put it abruptly. And all the other debts, starting with France, obviously, are totally decorrelated themselves in the market view. So France spread are moving on the opposite direction that German spread. So it means that there is Germany and there are the others. Knowing the fact that if you look at the supply, all the financing needs by the government, we cannot. Finland, for instance, has only 14 billion to finance next year. So there is only Germany and nothing else. This table is quite interesting as well. Is that why we have to respond to the market demand in a way? I'm sorry to say so, but we need to borrow every year 800 billion euros from the market. So clearly, if the market in a way wants safer assets, it's because we depend a lot on the market in the financing. So clearly, it gives you the magnitude of the needs on the market, 800 billion this year. An interesting point, I think, as well, is that in the next 2 years, it's really where everything is going to play. 3 years from now, probably the crisis will be settled or there will be no Eurozone anymore. I don't know, but it's a little bit binary in the outcome. But clearly, the next 2 years is really important in terms of supply of sovereign funds to be sovereign issues to be financed by the market. So if I come to our proposal, what we are seeing is that at the moment, I'm sorry, the commissioner is left, so I can speak more freely, but I think in our view, the FSF is not working. The investors are not willing to take on the FSF as a proxy of a sovereign debt. I think what is really, really, really important for investors is to have another sovereign issuer representing euro. The FSF is some kind of credit enhancement story. A story the non-euro investors are not willing to buy, I'm sorry, but clearly the FSF, in our view, is there to be used in terms of crisis, but we have seen in the past that in the middle of a crisis, the FSF is not able to pre-finance itself. The FSF is not a European monetary fund. It has to pre-finance itself. So, but the problem is, it's not able to finance itself in a period of crisis. So in our view, it's not working well, and it's not the solution because investors are looking at it more like a credit instrument, or the big investor in European in sovereign debt, central banks, sovereign wealth funds are looking for sovereign debt. The other solution might be the ECB. in our view, that will be the most federal, the existing federal solution. It will be really easy to solve the European crisis with the ECB. It will be less costly. I think the ECB is buying some bonds, but not in an efficient way. The ECB has bought 210 billion of sovereign debts without much effect. Once again, Italian debt are above 7%. Irish debt is at 10 years above 8%. So it's not working. Why it's not working? Because the ECB is not fighting the market. It would have been much more efficient if the ECB has given the investor selling a certain level of yield above which the ECB is not accepting any offer. So it would be fighting the market really efficiently. And I think that probably with about 10% of these 200 billion spent by the ECB, we would have made it. I want the example of the Swiss National Bank, for instance. Without any France-Swiss spent, they have defended the level 120, which is much more difficult to defend than the 6%, for instance, for the Italian BTP. So clearly, the ECB would be a solution, but for that, we have to change the Article 123 and make the ECB able to buy some debts, something which is a little bit of science fiction if we talk to the ECB and for many analysts. So that's not a solution either in our view in short term. So it's why we think the Eurobond is clearly something interesting to look at. In our view, once again, what we are proposing is an alternative. It's just for the sake of a discussion, but what we are considering is a bonus malus Eurobond. In fact, in this system, what we are doing is we set up a full Eurobond for the borrowing requirements of every Eurozone member state. We define some criteria of allocation once the Eurobond has borrowed from the market. These criteria can be chosen by the political side or by you guys. We decided, for the sake of the example, with deficit, debt ratio, rating, probably not the most accurate thing in our view, but still, deficit, debt rating, and GDP criteria. And with this criteria, we look at all the member states comply with this criteria. So depending on the performance of each member state regarding of this criteria defined politically, we set up a premium. A member state which is doing poorly will have to pay a premium. A member state which is doing better than this, which is doing really good, will receive a bonus in this area. So we have an allocation formula in which is a zero-sum game. And in this case, every single member state, in a way, we'll have a refinancing better than the current one. So we have made some calculations. Even the Germany in this case are refinancing themselves in a better way than there will be otherwise, which
show
is quite interesting.
Show the figure.
Yeah. Well hop, no, hop.
That's the formula. That's too complicated.
Yeah. Well, okay. Page 17, please. So we have some allocation formula we can see, and we get some allocation results. So the pricing is not really accurate because I didn't have the time to reprice it. But clearly, what you can see is that for the world Eurozone, you win about 30 billion compared to for as a whole. Even Finland and Germany are winners. And the cost of funding increased for Spain, Portugal, and Italy, but remains quite okay. Once again, you get just to make it perfectly clear, if possible, the Eurobond goes to the market. This Eurobond goes to the market, so you can think that the Eurobond will be a little bit better than the FSF. Currently, will be something double A plus. Will be financing itself around the Euribor plus 30, maybe 50 at the moment. And then once it's funded through these kind of levels, we just change the level. The level of finance for each member state according to this formula. As you can see, for each country, the losses or gain according to your performance with the criteria, which are debt, deficit, rating, or GDP. So it's another alternative to the all these things. Clearly, what is interesting in these things. Once again, you get joint liabilities. Once again, you get a new sovereign issuer. So it violates the no bailout clause. So you need to change all the treaty. You need to create a national European debt agency. So it takes a few years. Once again, we are it will take time. What's interesting is that you are fighting the moral hazard thing as well, is that everyone has an incentive to comply with the criteria, if it's a deficit, debt, or GDP. It means that every single member state has to strengthen its GDP, reduce its deficits and its debt to GDP to get some better refinance yield by the European agency. So that's still addressing the moral hazard, which is really central, as the commissioner said. I think every single Eurobond we are thinking of, which is a redemption, the blue bond, or review, the most important thing is to fight or to make it alongside some conditionality to make sure that we do not have moral hazard in this context. So this is as well, this bonus malus is addressing this this topic. So clearly, I will step down and we can discuss these things. In our view, it's been 15 years I'm in a dealing room, and it's the first time in the market, I think, that the market is really asking for politicians to do something in terms of institutionalization, in terms of organization. That's a really an historical opportunity, in my view. And I think there are two ways now. It's towards more integration or towards disintegration. And if we do nothing, clearly the ability of the market to finance the states can be really, really challenging starting this year. So I think we have to move on towards something, at least to have a pass for the investor to get back some confidence from investor. I'm really, really worried about the ability of non-euro investors to invest into anything from the eurozone unless they get the sense that we are moving towards something structural and probably, let's say, the world more federal in its approach to gain some confidence.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jean-François. Even if we have already had a lot of messages, and I know that there are many questions, I suggest that we give the floor to the last speaker, and then we open the discussion. I know it's difficult to be the last one, and the pressure of time is always on the last one, but please, Stuart.
Well, I'm very glad to have been able to join the panel. I first want to say how much I agree with the members of the European Parliament who said to the Commissioner, we're hearing about stability, where is the growth? The proposals from the Commission are for three types of stability bonds. The word growth appears once in the document in a footnote which refers to the Stability and Growth Pact. There is no reference to cohesion, there's no reference to levels of employment, there's no reference to recovery. And it starts with a remarkable statement that the concept of a European bond was first discussed by member states, it claims, in the late 1990s. And the concept of common issuance, yes, by the Giovanni Group. Well, this is missing one or two things. It misses that in 1993, the Commission, in the Delors White Paper, proposed union bonds, not simply for stability, but for both growth and cohesion. It misses that François Mitterrand, when there was a proposal for 50 billion écus of bonds, was challenged and said, I've checked with the Commission this morning, and that the this was in October 1994, and that the figure could be doubled to 100 billion ECUs. If this were made available to develop a European infrastructure, we could show that Europe could play a key role in promoting work, growth and jobs. Both Jacques Chirac and Romano Prodi called for European bonds. And Manuel Barroso and Tony Blair in Lisbon in 2003 called for bonds to finance a 10-year program to create the 15 million jobs, which was the employment growth target of the Delors White Paper. There's some politics missing here. That Delors White Paper, if I could, that's fine. Sorry, go back to the outline. I just want to talk about two things, that there should be twin bond strategies for stabilization and for growth. And let's try and move on with it, please. We can move off that as well. What's really needed is a Gestalt shift. I mean, it's actually very German. Because although national debt is very high, Europe has virtually no debt. The European Union itself had no debt at all until May 2010, when the European Central Bank started to give some money to some member states and to some banks. The United States should be as lucky as we are now. This is as if Tim Geithner could go into Barack Obama and say, hey, Mr. President, guess what? I've just abolished the federal debt. Well, it's down, actually, it's down to less than 2%, but that's nearly an accounting error. What do you want to do? And this, I think, is a very serious Gestalt problem. And I regret to say that it might not be unconnected, as Nietzsche once said, to the fact that the word for debt in German, Schuld, happens to be the same as the German word for guilt. But I'll leave that to Nietzsche rather than develop it right now. Next, please. Stabilization through union bonds. The EU could cut this Gordian knot by transferring a share. Now, here I agree with the Bruegel proposal. Transfer a share of debt of up to 60% of GDP to the union. But this does not have to be with mutual guarantees, nor does it need to be traded. It could be put by the union into a debit account, which is not traded, but is safeguarded from speculation by rating agencies. Secondly, recovery through Eurobonds. Eurobonds would be traded. They'd be traded in global markets. They will attract surpluses from the central banks of emerging economies and from sovereign wealth funds. Next, please. I think we can skip three or four of these. Yes, keep going. Yeah, that we just missed one point. The lost New Deal parallel. When I made the argument to Delors, and that was after studying the US many years ago at the Brookings Institution, when I made the case to Delors, it was that there never would be fiscal transfers between member states sufficient to fund cohesion. One or two of you may know that I was actually a member of the British Parliament, the Westminster Parliament, for 11 years. I didn't need to be there for 11 years to realize there wasn't going to be fiscal transfers funding cohesion with the UK involved. And the parallel I made to him was the US New Deal, because the whole debate at the moment is dominated by buying out debt, mutual sovereign guarantees of debt, fiscal transfers. Germany is opposed to all of these. So let me say something positive. In this regard, Mrs. Merkel is right. There are no need for them. Let's look at the historic parallels where bonds have been used to shift savings into investment, and they didn't need any of this. When Roosevelt funded the first 4 years of the New Deal, there was no deficit financing. There was no fiscal transfers. He didn't ask California and Delaware or Ohio to guarantee federal bonds. There was no buying out of national debt. Now, of course, the obvious point is that The US has a joint and common federal fiscal policy. Europe doesn't. But to stabilize the debt, if you transfer, and there are many ambitions by many people that there should be, and I recognize that. But what I'm trying to argue here, what I am arguing here, is that there are measures now which could be taken now with existing institutions and without treaty revisions, which both could stabilize the Eurozone crisis and could fund economic growth. I think I've covered the case, even though we seem to have only got to point two. Oh no, this is quite important. one of the things which, for example, I very much liked, made a note that Jean-François was saying, you know, if you're going to issue bonds, be serious about it. Get the European Central Bank to do it. That is, much of the work that I've been doing has been done with a Greek economist, Yanis Varoufakis, on what's called the modest proposal. Proposal modest only, and it doesn't demand treaty revisions, and it doesn't demand new financial instruments, and so forth. He was in New York recently and had a meeting. He told me, he said, I got a meeting at the Fed. So I said, oh, that's good. He said, there must be some misprint. They say there's going to be 150 people present. So I said, well, that indeed would be remarkable. There were 150 people present. Now, you don't hold a meeting like that at the Fed, even if Bernanke is not there. You don't hold a meeting like that on the case for the ECB to issue bonds unless there is serious support for it, and there was. The question asked was, why doesn't Europe get on with it? I'm going to finish in a couple of minutes. Then he had a meeting with Bloomberg. And Bloomberg said, when he asked, would it work, Bloomberg said, yes, of course it would work. So Yanis said to Bloomberg, well, sound out markets for me and find out at what kind of interest rate. This is net issues of euro bonds traded, not needing sovereign guarantees, because the emerging economies want a common European bond that they can invest in. And they want it as in store of value terms. They're not interested really in the interest rate. It can be a negative interest rate. As Guy has just commented, we're now into a world of negative nominal interest rates. What they want, why they want a common European bond, Eurobond, is to avoid a 20-30% depreciation of their holdings in further 20-30% depreciation of their holdings in dollars, in US treasuries. So thinking, how does one get this case across in Germany and get it across especially, because some people have already accepted the case for bonds. The proposal which our friends have made here is itself very interesting. Would she support the ECB issuing bonds? And my answer is no, she wouldn't. She'd oppose it. Now, actually, but there's a procedure called enhanced cooperation. Enhanced cooperation now means that at least 10 member states have to propose something. Now, are there or are there not 10 distressed member states or member states with debt distress in Europe now? You can formally move a procedure for enhanced cooperation which can be commented on by other member states, but they do not vote on whether to introduce the procedure. Now, I nonetheless would not propose that this should go ahead on the basis the European Central Bank should issue the bonds, even though the image that it's entirely independent is entirely wrong, because its primary responsibility is to preserve the stability of the currency, and its second is to support the general economic policies of the Union, which comes straight from the wording of the Bundesbank, die allgemeine Wirtschaftspolitik der Bundesregierung zu unterstützen. It's about, you know, what these policies, the general economic policies of the Union, can be defined by the European Council. Well, is it or is it not a general economic policy that we should preserve the Eurozone? Olli Rehn says yes. Well, let's use the available instruments. And it needn't be the European Central Bank. When I recommended the bonds, union bonds to the law, he set up the European Investment Fund. Now, the European Investment Fund for 20 years has done nothing except guarantee loans to small and medium firms. I wanted it to have a European venture capital market. I wanted the bonds to be used that the EIF could be a European venture capital market. That's a key point in competitiveness. Why should Germany be the only country to have Mittelstandspolitik? You know, I mean, we really need this. And it would work, and it wouldn't be cross-border transfers, as Olli was saying towards the end. I don't see cross-border transfers coming for years to come. Well, nor do many of us. And that's not the point. There would be net inflows of funds into the union from global surpluses, which also is a major objective of the G20. Anyway, I proposed this European Investment Fund. It was set up. It was designed to issue bonds, because we knew that for the ECB to issue bonds would be controversial. I happen to be an advisor to the Economic and Social Committee. We've got a meeting this week, which is quite convenient for me. At the last meeting we had, the EIB and the EIF had seen my proposals that the EIF should issue bonds. And they confirmed openly the EIF could issue euro bonds and it needs no treaty revision to do it. The instruments are there. It can be done by a simple decision of the Eurogroup on an enhanced cooperation basis. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, all of you, for these very creative proposals. I give the floor to Mr. Kreutzmann, then Mr. De Becker, Ramon Tremosa, and Olle Schmidt, and then in the second row, some others.
Vielen Dank.
Thank you. Well, we've heard of three types of euro bonds, but taking the last one, which is the easiest to deal with, the investment bonds that would be used also for investment, rather use euro bonds that are being used to fund consumption or to fund interest. I just have a couple of points, Professor Schmidt. We have an interest rate mechanism normally. You know, with drachma you used to get 10% more, whereby the interest rate premium actually offset the risk. But coming to your proposal, you're talking about getting rid of debt. And I think it's an interesting proposal from the Council of Experts as well, saying that we can't get rid of debt accumulated over a decade or longer straight away. So we have to deal with it on the 60% basis. And you built in a lot of safety first criteria, such as another member state having responsibility if one can't pay. What would happen if a member state did not work on that basis, if they got the proper rating, or you have the German negative interest rate? I mean, member states don't at that point if you've got 60% of GDP, but I'd like to know what sort of mechanisms you have if a member state were to go off the rails. Then secondly, on the blue bonds, these are fabulous, the 3 or 4A ones. Who's going to buy the red? I mean, you said people could buy up blue bonds. Well, of course they can. You can avoid a banking crisis then. You don't have to bail the banks out. But who's going to pay for the red bonds that are there, that have interest rates, but banks aren't supposed to buy, pension funds won't invest in them, and so on. So who's going to pay there? And then you've the general liability problem. The blue bonds are clean. Your difficulty is with the red ones, and I'd like to know who's actually going to buy them. What would the Council of Experts say as well about countries not respecting the criteria? You talked about the entry period, but is there then an exit period as well?
Just a couple of remarks to start off with. I just have three short questions and one thought. In the discussion about the redemption fund, I see on the notes that you take into account an economic growth of 3% for the next coming years. What happens if this is not the case? I mean, I think it's quite high given the circumstances we are under right now to remain at a 3% growth starting from next year. I mean, is this realistic? One, two, if not, what happens if the growth is much lower and it's much slower than you expect in your models? I had the same remark as Mr. Kreutzmann on the red bond issue. If banks are not allowed to take on those bonds, who will be able to take them on? It's not just a question of the legal structure behind it, but also who would like to take them on. That's, I think, a really important question if you talk about the red bond and the blue bond proposal. That are my two more technical questions. Of course, all the proposals that we see here before us, of course, are solutions towards governments who have problems today. The question is, will the proposals be enough to convince the markets today to be able to fund debt in the future? And every proposal that I heard here today that we already know of course, also contains not only at the beginning and at the setting up, at the creating of a framework, a political decision, but also during the process itself. So my question to all of you would be how, and this is maybe a little bit of a controversial remark, how can we take the politics out of it? How can we make sure that once we set up a certain system, that there will be no political interference or haggling during the process? Because I think, again, once this starts, and I think some of you may already made this comment, but I think once this starts as a political process, this really becomes a problem, and all the confidence in the market will diminish quite rapidly. So maybe a comment from all of you how you can eliminate the political process once the system has been set up. And the last remark on the last speaker, I think, we, of course, have to make a difference between how bonds are used today to create stability on the one hand, and, of course, the concept of using bonds, project bonds, as investments in the future. And I think, indeed, as Louis-Michel already mentioned in the beginning, that we have underinvested in economies of the future. I think that's clear as Europe that we have missed out on that. And I think, indeed, as you mentioned, the European Investment Fund there carries a heavy responsibility. I've worked in the venture capital world myself. I think it's really clear there that a lot of people are looking towards the European Investment Fund to sustain an internal market for venture capital, and that the IF is not performing well there. On the contrary, they're blocking some of the initiatives that are being taken. So I really, maybe you can expand a little bit more on how we can remove that, because as you maybe know, there's a proposal right now in the Parliament also for venture capital, and maybe we can link this also to the story of project bonds or bonds that can be issued by the European Investment Fund.
Merci, Philippe. Olli Schmidt.
Thank you. Olli Schmidt. Sorry, I'm on.
Discipline.
Thank you.
Thank
you, Sylvie. I promise a 10 seconds question. Which is the role of the ECB with the Eurobonds? Because I think that Eurobonds without explicit ECB support won't ever be a substitute for US treasuries. Thank you.
For being so short, Olli.
Thank you very much. I think this has been extremely interesting. I'm from a country outside the Eurozone, and I really want my country to join the Euro, so therefore I put this question. Because the opinion in my country, when we are discussing, for instance, Eurobonds, they are saying that, well, we did our job in the 90s, and now we are a bit better off. So why should we leave those countries and those politicians, perhaps not the citizens, but the politicians, to say that, well, we cannot manage on our own, so you have to help us in a sort of collective. We are very collective in my country, but this is the limit for many of the citizens, because these austerity measures in the 90s, they were extremely harsh. But in the end, I will say that I have tried to fulfill my mission as a member of the ECON committee, and I actually followed Sylvie Goulard as much as possible, because as I think it was Monsieur Delfa said, that perhaps this is the main challenge for the Eurozone. So therefore, I can realize the commitment. But these discussions does not make it more easy for me to advocate the euro in my country. Perhaps you could give me some good arguments for my fellow citizens to join the euro.
As you were very short, the lady here, Jan, and then we make the answer. I don't know your name, but introduce yourself.
Merci. Je suis, mon nom c'est
Vistella Valley. A physician, I'm a doctor, and I'd like to say something about European citizens and their view. For me, the euro is a political decision without an economic basis, and it's clear that there's a big effect on the euro during every financial crisis. But as far as I'm concerned, it's finance that's controlling economy rather than helping it to be promoted. I think it's much more important for the economic aspect to prevail over the financial markets aspect. Now, for euro bonds, any financial tax on citizens, they're always thinking, well, we're always the ones having to pay. We've got to bail the banks out. It's going to come out of our taxes. Banking services are extremely dear. They've become very, very dear as well. And a small example now, if I want my statements for the last 3 years, I have to fork out between 100 to 150 euros, whereas before the financial crisis, I had to pay 5. So that's affected me. So each euro bond you're going to inflict on people, as far as I'm concerned, it's always going to be my expense in a crisis. You're saying, well, my country has to pay for euro bonds to get Greece out of the financial crisis. Now, I love Greece, but my answer there would be no, because I'd rather keep my money for myself. In a time of crisis, I'm not up for helping other people that much. So just one small point. With the euro bonds, what are the conditions in the countries who are non-euro if they want to buy euro bonds? And then I think it has to be very short term for purely economic reasons. And finally, it's always France and Germany that make proposals. Now, being very sensitive about this, what about the countries with common economic interests getting together and saying, well, there's a crisis, so let's do this, that, and the other, because you've then various other permutations. Well, thank you for that citizen's comment. Yeah.
I have to say that I found it an extremely interesting afternoon. But there is one question that I still have. I think most of the euro bonds scheme, they will require a change of the treaty, which is always difficult and not possible, as far as I can see it, at a very short term. Now, I have a question to Professor Smit with his scheme. He says at the end, limited in time and scope, has a good chance to pass the ruling of the German Constitutional Court. Does that mean that his scheme can be implemented without a change in the treaty? Okay.
Thank you very much. I suggest that we give the floor to all the speakers, beginning perhaps by Mr. Holland, but please choose the question you prefer to answer. Don't try to answer all of you all the questions. Thank you. And then we conclude.
Just like to take Philippe's point, project project bonds, and could I elaborate on the European venture capital market through the EIF? The European Investment Bank has had a formidable role. It was thanks to Antonio Guterres, not Jacques Delors, that its terms of reference were widened to include investments from the Amsterdam Special Action Programme, to include investments in health, education, urban renewal, urban environment, new high-tech startups, green technology. But it's quadrupled its investments since then. Its investments are more than double those of the World Bank. I mean, we have a very powerful financial instrument here. But I agree with you, the EIF has failed. And it failed partly because our friends or their forebears in DG Economy and Finance fought vehemently against the Delors proposal that there should be bond finance and that this should fund a venture capital market. And they reduced, at the time, the EIF role to only loan guarantees, which is completely different. Who wants a loan guarantee when that's going to strangle you in the 3-4 years you need to get your high-tech startup going? But I think this can change. Even the Nice September 2008 decision, which was that there should be 35 billion new finance for small and medium firms, is mainly loan capital. But this is a very simple decision which doesn't need a treaty revision. It can just be decided by ECOFIN, because the governing body of both the EIB and the EIF is ECOFIN. But just briefly, if I may, on the other, what of the other countries in Europe not in the Eurozone who wanted to buy Eurobonds? Yes, let them, by all means. But I think the main vehicle that I see for growth is not giving. See, Olli Rehn made the argument, it's an absolutely familiar argument, you know, you can't get out of this crisis by, which is a debt crisis, by more borrowing. This is a debt crisis substantially because we've got no growth. You know, Clinton in his second term, he went for growth in his first term. In each of the 4 years of his second term, there was a federal surplus. You can generate, you can't, there's never been a history. The other cases Olli gave, for example, Denmark and the Netherlands in the 80s. Yes, there was an austerity adjustment, but the rest of Europe was growing. Yes, the rest of Europe isn't growing now. These policies are going to result in beggar my neighbor deflation, not growth. There's no historic example supporting such a mutual contraction of trade and income leading to a recovery. The argument depends, as our friends from DG Economy and Finance, of course, know perfectly well, on crowding out arguments. Heard a lot about crowding out arguments since Mr. Friedman came in. What is not recognized, however, is even Milton Friedman admitted that public spending only crowds out private spending if there is full employment. Whoever heard recently in Europe of full employment? The argument is a complete phony, and it's wrong. And the expansion, I think, should be, in order that there should be different ways of looking at fiscal responsibility, too. I wouldn't give, let's say, Chinese investment in Eurobonds. I wouldn't pass it to governments. I'd pass it through the European Investment Bank. It has a remit. It has criteria already decided. Its borrowing does not count on the national debt of any major Eurozone nation state. Eurobonds need not count on the debt of any major European major state. The Eurobonds, which could co-finance the EIB, we've got the instruments, we've got the means. We should stand up and recognize it and get growth and recovery onto the agenda, not only bonds for stability. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jean-François.
Maybe I take the question on the ECB. On the ECB, I think opinion on the Eurobond. I think my opinion as a formal central banker myself is that the ECB do not care. In fact, we had some opposition behind doors by Trichet at the time, but I think the point of the ECB is twofold. The third is the size of the collateral, and the second is the conditionality. In fact, in all these schemes we have presented to you today, I think the size will be there in terms of collateral size. What the ECB wants is to be able to make its monetary policy working, so it needs some good size of collateral accepted by itself. In this respect, so all these schemes, we have enough collateral of high quality, higher quality than this is the case at the moment. And I will add to that that at the moment, the collateral posted at the ECB is, contrary to most expectation, is not really govies, government bonds. In fact, it's much more ABS, much more bank loans at the moment, and very few government bonds are posted to the ECB. So in this respect, the collateral size, I think it's not a trouble. Even on the contrary, I think a Eurobond will be much higher quality than the average quality of Eurobonds at the moment, the national bonds at the moment, so it will be more positive for the ECB in this regard. Second thing, the conditionality. I think the opposition of the ECB that was to do with the absence of conditionality. What was feared by the ECB is that you will be releasing the effort towards fiscal consolidation. In every single scheme we have here, which is a redemption of blue bond or bonus malus, in every single scheme, you get some incentive towards fiscal discipline. So I think that's not a trouble either for the ECB on this regard.
Merci, Jean-François. Jacques, notamment les questions sur...
Thank you, Jack. If you can mainly talk about the red debt, the red bonds point.
First of all, I'm very happy that nobody questioned the blue bonds. So I consider that the blue bond battle has been gained, including with our German friends. They know that it's sure and safe because they've shifted the discussion to red. So thank you very much, very, very much. So he's fully aware that because blue bonds are so strong that a red bond should be so weak. So many questions about who's going to buy. First thing, it's true that red bond will have massively different interest rate. So your question about the difference of interest rate, all the spread would be massively shifted to red debt, which is national and full of cocoa and defaultable options. First of all, you know, people think that banks are buying most of the debt, which is not true. In normal times, when there is any auction, syndication, banks buy 15% of sovereign bonds. What is true is that when you have an auction, banks buy everything, but after they sell it to final investor. So banks, as final investor for regulatory revision, buy about 15% of sovereign debt in general. So if we refuse to have banks buying red debt, we have all the other ones. Insurers, asset managers, individuals, which is very important in Italy and in Belgium, sovereign wealth funds, national funds like Fonds d'Epargne in France or Caisse des Dépôts in Italy and the like. And those guys are the one who, there are some people buying equity. So red bonds are a quasi-equity. It's a very risky, it is the quasi-equity of government. So you have people buying very strange company equity. You will find people buying those sovereign quasi equity. So I'm not very much afraid about that. The role of the ECB. In our proposal, the ECB accepts only blue bonds as collateral, and we allow for, and the red bond is not allowed as collateral, and we allow for a gradual transition for that, not to have too much a shock. How to get the politics out? I like the question of our Dutch friend. Actually, I think we should Belgium. I think.
It's Europe.
Yeah. I think we must have politics in. I mean, I think economists or technocrats should just be in charge of giving advice on the possibilities which should be decided by politicians and MEPs and by you and your colleague in national parliaments. And so our proposal, I don't like the idea of a European Union, Euro Tsar. I disagree strongly with Jean-Claude Trichet on that. I don't like the idea of a super whip with no democratic accountability. Our proposal is completely intergovernmental and it's completely democratic accountable vis-à-vis national parliament. Each government, each parliament vote the guarantee for any vintage. So what you have guaranteed in the past remain guarantees until your redemption, but you can stop guarantee next year if you are not happy with XYZ government policy. So I'm very confident that the Bundestag would be very happy with that, to make things extremely clear. So our thing is completely democratic. If you don't want to, if you don't want to join, fine, you get out. So it doesn't matter if it's non-German countries. If Malta says, well, I don't like your blue bond proposal, well, fine, Malta get out. Same for Greece, Portugal, they are small countries. So basically our proposal means that de facto, Germany first and France second have a massive leverage in the sense that if they don't join, because of the two largest economy, the blue bond system has problem. Which leads me to the last thing is that who should join? I did not comment on that. I don't know if I can have a slide 34 of my presentation. I think the first best would be to have everybody join in except the three program countries who might join later. I think the second best, and from a French perspective, I think would be if really Germany is against, we should have a French-German blue bond in the first place so that Germany should feel confident about the design. And then we could have,
sure?
Yes.
Are you sure?
And the last, the third option, if really Germany for reason I could really understand, if Germany for political reason refuse to play the blue game, then I think we should really consider to have a blue bond with extremely tough criteria with all the countries except Germany and a few small ones who might refuse because of some political parties on the far right. Thank you.
Merci, Jacques. Jetzt auf Deutsch.
Thank you. Well, I don't know what Jack understands by blue. This is actually rude, but anyway, you can be as blue as you want.
Indeed, there's many similarities between the proposals Blue Bond, Red Bond, Mark II, and our proposal, but there are also very important differences. And as charming as the enthusiastic discussion or the enthusiastic remarks of just made are, I'm not as convinced, unfortunately, that the German public, the German parliament will be so much enthusiastic about this proposal. It's very similar in the sense that it also has some annual discussion about it. It's unlimited, but annually discussed, which is perhaps something that is even an element of instability, whereas ours is time limited but long. So you can emphasize the similarities or the dissimilarities here. We have a commitment to consolidation. I think your, if I may, your proposal is more working on market discipline. So we are really putting, but in a sense, our proposal is something, if you believe that it's an illiquidity problem, then probably that's the way to go. If you believe that some of the countries are already not illiquid, but under question, not illiquid, but are insolvent, then probably our approach would be the wrong one to go. Then probably you should go with your red bonds and make a default by cocoa or something possible. Our impression was, and our whole approach was, that the working hypothesis that the countries are only facing liquidity problems, the countries not under the EFSF, is the right assumption to go about. And I think when you want to, if and when you want to convince the German public and the German parliament and the German constitutional court, if it boils down to convincing Germans, as some of the remarks indicated, then I think financial architecture, even a very sophisticated one alone by itself will not suffice. I think that our proposal of putting forth an idea, a path for redemption of debt, redeeming debt, I think that's something that needs to be an element of that, despite all the similarities in our proposals. That brings me to the Zinsmechanismus, to the interest mechanism, because that the beauty of our approach, if I may, is that you use the interest rate gain for the countries just facing high interest rates to redeem debt, not to build up new debt, not to finance consumption, but to redeem debt. And in Germany, you hear in the moment quite often that that it's not all that problematic because countries like Italy have faced high interest rates before. And those remarks usually overlook the fact that that was high inflation time, a high inflation period, that nominal growth was much more intense, much higher. So it's really a problem. And I think breaking that spell of illiquidity, of dooming illiquidity problems is something worthwhile to as an endeavor. You asked for the mechanisms, what happens, or what are the safety valves in our proposal? Well, one is, of course, that it's always present. If you are entering a pact, then there's a reputation loss if you break it. But we are now well matured into the situation where that's alone not convincing enough. So that's why we have these currency and gold reserves pledged, and they would be forfeit. They would be gone. They would be used for redeeming the debt that the individual country doesn't redeem at the moment or in this instance. Then there are central bank profits that are distributed to the countries. You could just say, well, let's not distribute it to those countries. And of course, the most important aspect of, or the most important procedural aspect of our proposal is the roll-in, because during these 5 years, so many things will be decided. I think once countries are going to on the path towards consolidation, to reducing their structural debts and so forth, that's something that, like instilling a different attitude, a different culture, if that period is used in the right way, then I'm not afraid that in the next 15 to 20 years after, it would be easy to, by joint discussion, by adhering to, or by referring to reputational issues and so forth, it's possible to be convincing to all countries that they are really holding up their promises. I think these first five years, where we have breathing space, on the other hand, because of the pact, they are decisive. Your question about nominal growth or about growth of 3% is well taken, but be careful, please. This is nominal, and the 3% are something like the pessimistic projection already. We have written a report on Germany's upcoming demographic problems. And in our, and not only our, but in our recent assessment of the issue, 1% real growth would be something that Germany, as a very mature and rich country, is facing. So overall, in the euro area, 3% nominally is not looking like really such a daring projection. But it's clearly the case that you indicate a problem, because if it's not coming about, then everything will take longer, and 25 years is already a long time, so prolonging the process of redemption up to, or below, down to 60% is something that you wouldn't want to extend. So that's, again, a case in point for, clearly an argument for the case that you need to have structural reforms accompanying all these things. And here I would like to disagree a little bit with some of the discussion. I think that the potential for creating growth on non-private initiative is limited. I mean, there is a role for innovation policy by states. We have written extensively on innovation policy and on the very important part that intelligent policymakers and intelligent government can play in incentivizing people to take risks in pooling risks and so on. But it is an exploration process, and it can only come about with public initiative. If you want, but that's something that we could discuss about in another long session. But I think the most important part is here, or point here is, that you want to convince investors. And if you tell investors, well, give us our money for Europe, and the European policy sphere is knowing what is best to do with this money. We are creating growth by an intelligent industrial policy. I'm afraid that investors won't buy that. I wouldn't buy it personally, but it's my personal opinion. But I think investors won't buy it, and I think that's exactly the problem. We are in the hands of the financial markets, and that's something that was asked here in a very charming way as a comment by a citizen. Indeed, taking up debt means you have more leverage to do good things, but it also puts you in the hands of the financial markets. So if you don't have a lot of debt, you don't have a high interest to pay annually, you have more, and you just use your tax money instead of accumulating more and more debt, then you have more leverage to do good things and are not in the hands of the financial markets. And that's exactly what our proposal is trying to re-achieve, getting back to healthy debt levels, debt below 60%. And one thing, it's not a treaty change that is required.
Merci, ça va faire la transition, je crois, avec la conclusion de notre...
Thanks very much. So that gives us time to go back to our president for the conclusion.
A few conclusions. First of all, that the Americans have established their treasury certificates in 1790. So that was 5 years after the Convention of Philadelphia, when they became a federal state. So that's quite a lot of time ago that they did that. And I think we can learn something from that. Because at that moment, the budget of the federal state of the US was 1% of their GDP. So there is some resemblance with what we have in the Union for the moment. But I think it's important in this conclusion to say, yeah, there is a problem today. Bond markets are blocked today. That's the reality. Yeah? Institutional investors like pension funds or insurance companies or banks, etc., are for the moment not looking to bonds of European countries, of Eurozone countries, to buy them. It is less risky to buy shares of a company than to buy bonds of Eurozone countries, and that's a problem. There is the markets are blocked not only by European institutional investors, but also certainly by American institutional investors, and they shall not come back, I think, if we are not solve this problem first of all by a credible solution and a sustainable solution. And we are now in a system where we have, as I indicated now, of nominal negative interest rates for Germany, what can only increase the tensions inside in the Eurozone. Mm. And we are now in a situation where yesterday, I think, you have to, when you give 100,006 euro, after 6 months, you receive 100,000 euro. That is what's happening today. The nominal negative interest rate, so you have to pay money if you want to give that 6 months to the German authorities. So that's now a temporary situation, we know it, but can only increase the problems with other countries who have then debt interest rates to pay of 25 or 26%. How you can continue with a monetary union where you have such differences with nominal negative interest rates on the one side and with high interest rates on the other side, I think it's not sustainable. So we need urgently a solution. I think that the two-track approach is obvious. It's not only about stability, it's about stability and growth. And maybe, I don't know, but a combination of all what we heard here today can be the solution, in the sense that, yeah, let's start in any way with redemption fund, because then we can use the liquidity premium to go back to the 60%, because that is what we mainly do. You use the liquidity premium of a Eurobond market that exists, that is a reality, and you use it to go to the 60%. And once we have experienced that, we shall say, oh, that's fine. We have liquidity premiums with common issuance. Why not using it on the 60% then? So I don't see any contradiction. Yeah, any contradiction between starting with a European Collective Redemption Fund, where you use the liquidity premium to go to the 60%, and then saying, oh, we have a liquidity premium, let's now use it also on the 60%. Now, I think, we have mainly three criticisms to the Eurobond system, and we know them, certainly also in our group. We hear them mostly in a German language, or Finnish language, in our group. First of all, it needs institutional changes. I think we know now that a number of proposals don't need institutional changes. And if so, we are now two times changing the treaty for the moment. Okay. Secondly, it's creating moral hazards. I think it's also clear that a number of these proposals, and certainly the blue bond, red bond proposal, is the opposite of it. And three, the third criticism that we heard, yeah, triple A countries shall pay more. Well, we got here an exercise by Natixis showing that also the triple A countries are paying less on their debt with such a proposal. It's true that the gains are more important for countries like Greece and Italy. That's obvious. That's because they have an enormous public debt. But there are also gains. There is also a profit for triple A countries because of this liquidity premium that exists. Let's face, I think that there are certainly, we can find a solution for all the technical problems that exist around these proposals. The problem is a political problem today in Europe. It's not a technical one. It's not one of, oh, can it be done, yes or no. And the question is how to overcome that. Well, I think that the financial markets shall help us to overcome that. I don't think that we are convincing enough to those who are against the idea. Those who are convincing and shall convince shall be the financial markets. If this is continuing, and if at a certain moment a country, for example, as France, have difficulties to find the money to cover their debts and their deficits at that moment, that's another question, because then we are talking really about the heart of the Eurozone, the heart of the European Union, and the project itself. And then you have only, and that has been said, one choice to make. Or you are, you stop with the euro, you disintegrate, and maybe it can be the end of the European Union. Or you go to a bond market in one or the other way. And a last point, I think we have already put an enormous amount of money to try to solve this crisis. An enormous amount. In the EFSF, we shall do it in the ESM, with bilateral loans, with the European Central Bank using money to come in on the markets. At the end, if we had the courage to start with this system 2 years ago, I think that the cost was less big for many countries of the European Union that we have paid now. I think the fact that a few months ago they announced a political leadership that the private sector should be involved in a default, of a partial default, has cost many billions of euro more than this system that can help. That is my conviction about what is happening for the moment. That is a reasonable, we don't want to pay for it. No, we pay to institutional investors who are asking more interest rate because of stupid ideas that was launched a few months ago, and where the political leaders are now saying, oh, we shall not repeat it. I'll be sure we shall not repeat that in the future. So thank you very much for the present. I found it a very stimulating, and I think our German friends also. Thank you very much.